English is the only Latin-derived language that doesn't use gender-noun associations. So for a minute, let's try and associate these nouns with a gender.
Makeup, feminine. Trucks, masculine. Hockey, masculine. Swimming, maybe both. Scientist, masculine. Construction worker, definitely masculine. And medical professional, maybe both?
So why is it that we associated the medical professional to be both masculine and feminine, but the construction worker and the scientist had a predominantly masculine association? It's because caring or nurturing professions align with the prevailing attitudes about women. This is unconscious gender bias, and this is what contributes to the gender disparities seen in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, otherwise known as STEM for short. Canada is viewed as a progressive nation in popular culture. So why is it that we have one of the lowest percentages of women in engineering? And this percentage isn't changing. We've known about gender bias for about 30 years, and although some industries like medicine are seeing increased diversity, obviously engineering is not. This graph shows that although the number of students going into engineering is increasing, the percentage of those who's female remains the same. This is a big problem with a lot of underlying causes and a wide range of repercussions. And although I don't have time to talk about everything, I'm going to try to explain why gender disparity in STEM is a problem, what causes this unconscious bias, and ways we can work together and try to fix this. So why do we care about the demographic going into STEM? It's because we live in a time where society is facing complex global issues and an unprecedented rate of technological advancement. If our country wants to remain on the forefront of innovation and drive our economy in the process, we need to educate our best leaders, thinkers, and doers. Right now, Canada has a shortage of engineers, and if we're going to exclude half the population based on gender, you're going to miss out on a lot of promising talent. Now let's talk about why more girls aren't going into STEM. Perhaps the biggest contributor to this is self-concept. Science says that girls need to see a reflection of themselves in their education and future careers in order to want to pursue it. Right now, the engineering industry does not showcase an equal demographic of men and women, which makes it extremely difficult for girls to see themselves in those engineering roles. Additionally, science says that girls have lower self-confidence compared to boys. This means that a girl who is just as capable and receives similar grades to boys will still perceive herself to be not smart enough to continue with hard subjects in high school, and then they're more likely to drop out or switch majors once in university. This also means that girls think that they have to work harder to receive the same reward as men. And even when they are rewarded, they feel like they don't deserve it. That's known as imposter syndrome. So obviously this is a STEM perception issue and not linked to women's ability or performance. External influences can also shape how girls perceive engineering. Unfortunately, teachers, guidance counselors, and parents can have outdated perceptions of what engineering is. They often view engineering as an inhospitable career choice for girls and unconsciously promote paths in STEM to boys instead. In addition to this, studies show that lack of career guidance or lack of female STEM role models can also directly relate to women not even considering paths in STEM. And this statistic only increases for less privileged groups. But these are all factors of why girls don't go into STEM. There's also a big problem retaining women in industry after graduation. That's because women are often charged with raising children or caring for family members, which makes it extremely difficult for them to rise to leadership roles. We need to increase the integration of women in STEM by conveying that STEM is a tool that can be used to open doors for women. And the best way to convey this message is to support the outreach programs that are working in schools to promote STEM to girls. We've got to create excitement around math and science and let girls know it's okay for them to shine. They don't have to limit themselves. And this encouragement has got to start quick, as early as 14, and it's got to persist throughout high school when things start to get tougher. By supporting these outreach programs, we're forming partnerships with like-minded individuals and building alliances. By joining together, we can work on these issues collectively. We also need to make sure that we're properly educating ourselves on equality, diversity, and inclusion, or EDI for short. A study recently revealed that the majority of trusted EDI programs, although they do actually increase bias literacy and promote collective action, unfortunately, they decrease women's sense of belonging in STEM since it highlighted the stereotypes. If we want to overcome this consequence, we have to make sure those training programs showcase positive female STEM role models and that they convey the message that this gender bias can be overcome. If we mandate proper EDI training programs in industry and schools, we're going to establish a culture for intolerance towards biased behavior. And it's not just up to women to fix these issues. Enabling and educating men is perhaps one of the most powerful ways we can overcome this gender bias. We've got to teach men how to remove the obstacles that women face, rather than teaching women how to jump over them. If men stop standing by and refuse to participate in projects that offer low diversity, it's going to strengthen our culture for intolerance towards biased behavior. This might be difficult for them. It's hard to pass up an opportunity, right? But my advice for them would be to start getting comfortable with being uncomfortable, because it's the world that women in STEM live in every day. The professional industry can also do their part to promote diversity and enable success for women. Having a flexible environment and working hours can help facilitate the success for women who are primary caregivers. Having transparency in pay rate averages and a clear HR process for discrimination and harassment will also establish a workplace culture of equality. Finally, having proper EDI training programs will help eliminate unconscious bias for employees in day-to-day activities. It's up to all of us to be educated on unconscious gender bias and take collective action to overcome the obstacles that girls and women face. It's not about ensuring that every girl enters STEM. It's about making sure that the girls who do have a passion for math and science know that they can and should continue, and that they have bright futures ahead of themselves in STEM. I hope that by listening to this talk today, you begin to think about things differently and consciously make choices that will help shape future generations. Thank you.